Good morning, Calvin members and friends of Calvin. I'd like to welcome you to worship this morning. I'd also like to invite you to join Reverend Mary in her midweek meditations that are on Facebook. It's a great time to pause and reflect on the Word of God and how it applies to our lives.
My friends, hear now this opening prayer and call to worship. The opening prayer is from the theologian and professor Howard Thurman. Listen for this word. Lord, open unto me. Open unto me light for my darkness. Open unto me courage for my fear. Open unto me hope for my despair. Open unto me peace for my turmoil. Open unto me joy for my sorrow. Open unto me strength for my weakness. Open unto me wisdom for my confusion. Open unto me forgiveness for my sins. Open unto me love for my hates. Open unto me thyself for myself. Lord, Lord, open unto me. Amen. My friends, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the Lord is near to all of us. Let us worship God in spirit and in truth. Amen.
Good morning, young disciples, and God bless you today. It's wonderful to see you, and I'm so glad that you are with us. You wonder why I'm wearing this mask, don't you? Don't you wonder? I thought you might. Well, I'm wearing it for a couple of reasons. I'm wearing it because whenever we go out, we have to wear it to be safe. Because as long as there's the pandemic that can make us sick, we have to use a mask to help us to protect other people and also ourselves. But I'm also wearing it because I wanted you to know that sometimes people wear masks and they think you can't see what's behind it. How about that? Well, I want you to know that even though you may not be able to see my nose and my mouth and the whole rest of my face behind the mask, you can still tell by my eyes if I'm smiling or if I'm not. Because when we smile behind a mask, our eyes crinkle right up in here. And the older you are like me, the more they crinkle. But that's a good thing. But there's another reason why I was wearing that mask. And that's to prove a point that we are human beings. God made us, but God is perfect and we're not. So when we wear a mask, we might not be able to see behind the mask, but God can. In the Old Testament, there's a story about Moses. When Moses was leading the Hebrew people through the wilderness all the way to the Promised Land. Well, at one point, Moses would go up way up on the mountain where it was just Moses, and he would talk to God and pray to God and really pray about his people. Well, when he would go into the place to meet with God, he would take off the veil, because when he wore the veil before the people, he had to protect the people. Because when he would come out from having been in this place with only him and God, praying and talking and planning for how he could take care of the people, when he came out, he would have a light on him that was so bright and shiny that it was too bright for the people. Do you know how it is when you've been asleep and you're in the dark and someone turns on the light and it's too bright right then? That's how it was for the people. Well, the people would tell him it was way too bright. So Moses would wear a face covering like some of us wear today, like this, but it would cover his whole face so he could see them. But the light would be a little dimmer so the people could look at Moses. But when Moses would go
in to worship and pray and talk to God way up on that mountain, he would take the mask off. He would take the veil off. Well, even if he had kept it on, God would know, because God knows everything, because God knows everything there is to know and knows everything there always was to know. So even if we wear a mask, God knows what's in our hearts. God knows what's behind the mask. So even if we don't tell how we're feeling or what we want to talk about, even if we don't tell anybody, God still knows, because God knows everything. So my friends, when you wear your mask, just know we can tell by your eyes if you're smiling. We can hear you if you're talking. And God will always know everything. I'm going to add something to that. God and your mom and dad always know everything. God bless you. See you soon, okay? Ask your parents to read you that story about Moses and wearing the veil and how it covered him for the people and protected the people. But when he went in to pray and talk to God, he took the veil off because God knew all about him anyway. And God knows all about you. God bless you and God keep you. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we're so grateful that you know everything about us. You know what we think before we think it. You know what we're going to say before we say it. Bless these young people. Keep them ever in your care and let them know that yes, when we wear masks to protect other people and ourselves, you still know what's in our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. See you next time. Bye-bye.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of a Savior. Can move the mountains.
The scripture reading for today is Luke 15, 25 to 32. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and now is found."
My friends, today we have a very special story and a very special message from the book of Luke, chapter 15. When you read this entire chapter, and I pray that you will, Jesus shares three parables that are of primary, paramount importance for the people. You see, the Pharisees continued to be upset with him, to be jealous of him, to be self-righteous and self-centered in their thoughts about whom Jesus should be with. He ate with tax collectors and sinners and was able to change their lives. However, the Pharisees thought he should not eat with them or be in their company because they were not as important as the Pharisees, but because they were sinners. And Jesus shares three important stories. One about the lost sheep, and the time that the shepherd would take to locate the one lost, because if the other 99 were safe, the fact that one was lost was important, because all are important in God's kingdom. The second was about the woman who lost her coin. She lost one coin and had many others, took the time to look for that coin, to sweep through her home, to spend all of her energy finding that one, and to celebrate. You see, God celebrates when there is one soul that is one for Jesus Christ. And it doesn't mean that all of them are not important, but what it means is that all of them are important. This last story is quite touching. And it's the story of the prodigal, or the prodigal son, as we learned it growing up. It's a story of a younger brother who insisted on receiving all of his inheritance and then squandered it all away. Then when he was reduced to tending swine for a Gentile in Gentile territory, and as you may remember in reading some of this and learning some of the history, the Jewish people did not consider swine the kind of animal that they should eat or anything that they should take time with. And so he had been reduced as low as he could go, as broke as he could be, as despondent as he possibly could. And then our scripture says, and then he came to himself. And that very phrase has so much meaning and so much symbolism. And it is important that we remember that he came to himself. The scripture says he rose and he returned to his home. So he came to a point in his lowly existence, having been broke, homeless, shamed beyond imagination, and he finally was able to regain his common sense, good judgment, and remember the teachings of his youth. So he came to himself. He realized where he was in life. He realized all that he had done that had not only shamed his family, but shamed himself. And then he rose. He lifted himself physically and spiritually and emotionally and returned home. Well, his father happened to be where he could see him, came to meet him, and requested of the servants to get the best robe, to put it on him, to kill the fatted calf so they could celebrate because a lost soul returned. And the older brother was upset. He didn't want to join the festivities. He wouldn't even go into the house to celebrate. He told his father many things that expressed his anger with the brother having left and seemingly gotten away with squandering his money, loose living, throwing away his inheritance, his good name, and then returning home. And the son reminded the father that he had always been obedient. He had never left him. But he said, "You've never given me even a young goat and celebrated with me and my friends. But when this son of yours returns home, you do all this great celebration." My friends, let's pick up at verse 25. When you are able, I encourage you to read this entire chapter. And let's think about all the ways that we have perhaps dismissed those that we didn't think were as important, where we may have been angry about something that we should have been celebrating, where we may have forgotten that God loves everyone. There isn't one of us who hasn't sinned or made a mistake or done something we shouldn't have done or behaved in a way that was shameful to ourselves ultimately. But God forgives, God loves, God celebrates with us when we come to ourselves. Listen now for the word of God. "Now his elder brother was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. The slave replied, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has got him back safe and sound.' Then the brother became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command, and you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him.' Then the father said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate, we had to rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found.'" May God add blessing, understanding, and wisdom to this reading of God's holy word. My friends, this story is most meaningful. It's most meaningful because all of these feelings are human natural feelings. The feeling of an older child being a little bit jealous of the younger one. The tendency of families to often place one child's well-being over another without even realizing it. Or sometimes celebrating when one who has lost has been found. In previous times when I've preached from this passage, I have called it either lost and found or coming to oneself. Today, we will merely share that God loves us all, and there is not one of us, older brother, sister, younger brother, sister, who hasn't made some mistakes or upset the family or demanded something that we were not entitled to. You see, in ancient times, in family distributions of property, of wealth, of belongings, the older son would receive a double portion because that was the older one, that was the one who was considered most responsible. And in some settings, there was a need to want to shelter and protect that older son from having property or funds being tricked out of their belonging or tricked away from them. So they received the blessing of the oldest child and would receive a double portion. But each child would receive something. So in this story, the younger son wanted all of his inheritance all at once. All of his inheritance, or one translation says, all of the father's life. His life earnings, his life savings, his life's work, his life's sweat, that he would distribute to his sons upon his death. So all that would become his, the younger son wanted immediately. And when he received it, he left and went off to a far off country, Gentile land, so to speak, and squandered away his money. When he lost all his money, as I mentioned earlier, he then was reduced to going to a Gentile swineherder and getting a job feeding them and working for them. And then he became so hungry and so destitute that there were the carob pods that were fed to the pigs, and he felt like he should eat them. And in times of extreme difficulty, there were people, Gentiles ordinarily, who ate those pods because they had to have some nourishment until things got better for them. And this reminds me of an old spiritual that says, I believe I'll go back home. I believe I'll go back home and acknowledge there that I've done wrong. In my father's house, there was bread enough to spare. I believe I'll go back home and acknowledge that I've done wrong. My friends, the younger son acknowledged what he had done wrong, that he did not deserve to be called his father's son, but he would take the place, a servant's place, so he could have shelter and food and make up for what he had done. And the father was so happy that he was alive and well and returning home and had come to himself and was willing to acknowledge what he had done. The father said, he is alive. Let us celebrate. We celebrate when just one soul comes to Jesus Christ, when just one person of a million or 100 or 1,000 says, I believe, I acknowledge, I claim Jesus Christ as Lord. We celebrate because that one can share with others, because that one life is as important as any other. Believe in the gospel, my friends, today. You are loved. You are forgiven. God has bestowed a means of grace upon you that lasts for now and all eternity. Believe in the gospel. Be at peace. God values your life. God values you. God values your soul from now unto eternity. We were lost and have been found. We are found in Jesus Christ. So when we are lost in sin, we are found in forgiveness. When we are lost in selfishness, we are found in God's generosity. When we are lost in wastefulness and self-righteousness and self-servance, God gives the best God has in Jesus Christ to save our souls, to promise us eternal life, to love us forever. You are loved. Believe in the gospel today and touch someone else's heart with the gift that has been given to you. God bless you. Amen.
Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Hello, Calvin. Reverend Mary and your session would like to pray for you. Please call the church office or email the church with any prayer requests. Call 757-587-1591 or email officecalvinbc@gmail.com. That's call 757-587-1591 or email officecalvinbc@gmail.com.